So we just heard part of the Mozart's Laudato Dominum, Praise the Lord, Psalm 117. Praise the Lord, all you nations, praise him, all you people, for he has bestowed his mercy upon us, and the truth of the Lord endures forever. This beautiful piece by one of the greatest composers, Mozart, had been heard. I'm very joyful and very happy to begin this presentation. It's a great honor for me. I'm Niko Chocheli, a fine artist, iconographer, a book illustrator, artist from country of Georgia. And I'm here to do a presentation about the beauty, about timeless beauty. I'm a fine artist, as I mentioned, and therefore being a painter, being an artist, I've often had these questions concerning fine art, have been often asked about meaning of art, its purpose, how art relates to God, how art is glorifying God. And therefore, I would like to dedicate the series of lectures to this particular topic. I'm in my atelier, in my art school, in my studio right now, as I speak to you. This is the first part of the series of the lectures, and we'll talk about true meaning of art. And this series of lectures, this first lecture, I dedicate to blessed memory of my very dear friend, Levitt Kinner, whose face shone as a great inspiration to all of us. He was a really, really remarkable human being, and I would like to dedicate this first lecture to him, to his memory. I would like to read few quotes as we begin, and I want you to listen to them and see what you hear and what you understand hearing them. Begin by adoring yourselves with these vestments: love, fear of God, obedience, and perseverance. Cennino Cennini. Art is gift of God and must be used unto his glory. That in art is highest, which aims at this. Michelangelo. Help us to recognize your voice. Help us not to be allured by the madness of the world, so that we may never fall away from you, O Lord Jesus Christ. Albrecht Dürer. The true work of art is but a shadow of divine perfection. Michelangelo. I play the notes as they are written, but it is God who makes the music. Johann Sebastian Bach. Only God creates, the rest of us just copy. Michelangelo. The artist is chosen by God to fulfill his commands. Albrecht Dürer. What we have is given by God, and to teach it to others is to return it to him. Gian Lorenzo Bernini. Painting contains a divine force which makes the dead seem almost alive. Leon Battista Alberti. Do not fret, for God did not create us to abandon us. Michelangelo. Life without love is no life at all. Leonardo da Vinci. A painting is complete when it has the shadows of a god. Rembrandt. The painter should paint not only what he has in front of him, but also what he sees inside himself. Caspar David Friedrich. I interpret with my heart as much as my eye. Jean-Auguste Dominique Ingres. The act of painting is about one heart telling another heart where he found salvation. Francisco Goya. It is the special province of music to move the heart. Johann Sebastian Bach. I am a poor man of little worth, who is laboring in that art that God has given me. Michelangelo. I am just a simple man standing alone with my old brushes asking God for inspiration. Peter Paul Rubens. A knowledge of yourself will preserve you from vanity. Cervantes. The aim and final end of all music should be none other than the glory of God and the refreshment of the soul. Johann Sebastian Bach. And here I'm going to gently reinterpret this and paraphrase it as: aim and final end of all art should be none other than the glory of God and the refreshment of the soul. So this is it. You heard all these wonderful quotes by great artists, great painters, sculptors, architects, great musicians, great writers, and discover how close they are to God, how much they glorify God. They almost sound like written by church fathers. They don't look like the stereotypical understanding of artists we always would imagine the artist would be. Free-spirited, unruly, undisciplined, kind of bohemian lifestyle. No, those are serious men who dedicate their lives to glorify God. And the art is their tool and their vehicle. Because really, ultimately, everything which is on this in this world is designed and created to glorify God. And art is no exception. I've been looking at this beautiful flower here in my studio, this beautiful teeny tiny little red flowers, each and every one of them glorifying God. In their little gentle beauty, they reach out to Creator and say, look, I'm here because of you, and I would like to share your joy, joy you've given me, to the rest of the world. The same thing is art. Why should art be an exception? As an artist, as an iconographer, as a painter, as a teacher, I've been often asked about meaning of art, its purpose, its significance. Those are profound things. And we have to understand, as Orthodox Christians, we have a vast riches of spiritual legacy, our iconography, which is a liturgical art, which is art where we worship in front of them the Trinity, where we venerate the saints, where we glorify God through those beautiful icons, which are part of our life, the part of our birth and the rest of our life, and then we come to this world with them and leave this world with them. And they have their place and meaning and significance, which is immense. And they have their own place in our life. But we should not forget that also even art, which is different kind of beauty, material beauty, and we sometimes wonder, is material beauty able to glorify God, or is it just superficial? But I would like to assure you that the beauty, which is really the most important and only the greatest attribute of art, is designed and created by God, and it returns back to God, it's His glory. So we have to remember this. Fine art is not just to depict something, but it's really to give glory to God. And you give glory to God by discovering beauty. And if you discover beauty, therefore, you discover God. So everything really has a ways to reach out to Creator. And those great artists, which we are about to explore and see their works, through their work, knowingly and unknowingly, because not every artist may have been a Christian. Many artists may have been an Orthodox Christian at that. But as long as artists glorified God, as long as artists reached out to Creator, as long as artists seeking beauty, artists finding God, and directly or indirectly touching upon something which is bigger. And therefore, we should be able to appreciate the beauty through their work, through their struggles, the best of what they found. And many of those people were pious people, many of those people loved God, and many of those people understood that the timelessness of what art is all about, it's not just human-invented attribute, but it's something which is eternal, and eternal is which something comes from God. So it all rotates and returns back again to a Creator. So our aim again is today, and in this lecture series, to bring you close to the truth of a fine art, and discover that through beauty we can approach God, and we can glorify Him properly, and have a joy. Joy is the expression which is called art. So let me start from the very beginning, and beginning of everything. And in the very beginning of everything was, is, and always will be God. God created this world and us in it, making us in His image and likeness. Art is a talent of Creator endowed to us, and therefore it's a perfect tool of imitating Him. So what is the purpose of art? Purpose of art is not just to just narrate the facts, show the world around us, or even be truthful in seeing nature and delight in conveying reality. No, not only. purpose of art is to serve God by glorifying Him, give Him an honor and admiration. That is the purpose of true art. And that's what we should really be aware of. And that's why we should be very focused on this particular element. But in order to do that, artists must have to do one thing, the most important thing, to discover beauty. The art and beauty are inseparable. And we have to know that too. Through beauty, artists elevates, brings joy, or makes heart palpitate in genuine feeling. Actually, art must transform, not accept things as they are, but transforms them into something noble, dignified, something which rises us up, not depresses or kind of casts us down, not brings a darkness in our life, but brings a joy. Because again, it points to God. As well-known architect and art critic of 17th century, André Philibien, put it, "The heart of the faithful can be raised to divine love in a thousand ways." And truly, art must possess those thousand ways of reaching out to divine. We're seeing this beautiful Titian painting, and we are again and again reminding them of those eternal truths. Of beauty and admiration, adoration, and love of God. And the brush of the artist is used as a tool, as a wonderful tool to open up for us the visage of a beauty, and through visage of beauty to peek into heavenly realm. Beauty contains them all, you know, all of those wonderful and thousands of ways, as I mentioned. You captured beauty, therefore you are giving glory to its true creator, God Himself. Artists must make this discovery of beauty and then share it as freely as it was given to him. So if purpose of true art is to glorify God, then all art is religious. You know, we often think that religious art means art which depicts religious topics. Not just so-called religious-themed art can be called religious, I'll repeat. Names, styles, movements, categories are all invented by art historians to make easy definitions and to label things and to navigate through history of art. These are no art movements. There are no art movements. There are only artists. Unique individuals called to point to God through beauty. Yes, of course, there are some similarities in styles and times, but again and again, we categorize them. In reality, there is a one reality. A true art is religious. Whether it's a still life, whether it's a landscape, whether it's a portrait, it's all religious if it's done in a correct spirit. And there are no styles, no styles at all. There are only individuals, individuals who reach out to God because their heart is ablaze. They point to God. So again, we're looking at the landscape, we're looking at the religious art, even it shows the fields, the mountains, the rivers, and seas, and moonlight, sunsets. Why? Because those phenomena, those occurrences, those natural phenomena, they all glorify God. Mountains glorify God, fields, the rivers, the seas, they're all created by Him. Sunsets, sunrises, we look at still life, with vast variety of inanimate objects. Well, where those objects come from? Who created them? Portrait art, with many faces of humanity, young and old, wise and joyful, smooth or wrinkled, they are all religious art samples. If they are done in proper and true spirit, they are, because everything and everyone are created to give glory to God. Mountains and oceans, in their majesty, awe-inspiring sunsets, mysterious moonlights, grand waterfalls, graceful and brilliantly colored flowers, vast animal kingdom, singing and flying birds, human beings and creation of their hands, feelings of their hearts, all united in one thing, praising of Almighty God, their Creator. We remember all Psalm 148. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for He commanded and they were created, and He established them forever and ever. He fixed their bounds which cannot be passed. Let artists with their art praise the name of the Lord, and if they do, their art too will be established forever and ever, bringing joy to generations to come. That's what great art does. Michelangelo, Leonardo, Raphael, Rubens, Rembrandt, Titian, Velasquez, Veronese, Vermeer, and many, many others, whose work we are about to explore today, to trace God's presence in a form of beauty, that's eternal truth they have captured in their creations. Now, through centuries, in selecting the most worthy subject matter to depict, artists chose crown of creation, which is a human being. His life, his struggles, his strivings, joys, sorrows, heroic deeds, his noble aspirations and greatest sacrifice. So to put in still in categories, which I try so hard to avoid, we still can kind of find certain kind of logic here. And throughout history, number one, which always had been elevated in the highest levels through artistic, in artistic circles in history of art, with highest status and preeminence in selection process, was called the historical painting, which broadly covered history, biblical history, New and Old Testaments, right? Mythology and literary subject matter, all most important, beneficial for depiction things, all to elevate, improve, and enlighten the viewer. So in throughout art history, the highest honor would go to the historical art, but it's not just only talking about history. It was, as I said, biblical and mythological and literary subjects. So everything which would involve human being. Number two in its importance after historical painting and historical art was in its importance would be a portraiture. Human face as a mirror of a soul. Standards were high though. Art had to surpass original. Boggles the mind. Portrait had to ennoble, grasp inner man, not the outward likeness. So even portrait was not as important as historical painting, because it was just a face, and historical painting would have more than just a face. It would, that face had to be more than just a sitter. It had to go and penetrate in the depth of the human nature, in the depth of the human soul, but not to drag us down, but bring us up closer to God. So the greatest portrait masters reached that level and achieved it. And we'll see some of those works, and you will see they'll speak for themselves. Now, number three in this hierarchy would be everyday life, or so-called genre painting. Those are different kinds of heroes there. Quiet and happy, serene, blissful, joy of a toil or a hard work, or joyful life in a domestic scenery, work. Those would be subject matters which might not be as great as historical painting would cover, but it would convey things which would be close to a heart of a human being. And again, the joy will be coming because they were given by God. Number four, it's a latecomer in art history to our also. To our surprise, maybe, as independent genre is a landscape where beauty of nature is depicted, pointing to riches of nature, surrounding without preeminence of a human being in the scene. We love landscapes, of course we do, but throughout art history, landscape was accessory, usually would be the backdrop or background of historical painting. But 17th century, especially, a genre start to develop very strongly in Holland, in the Dutch art especially. And then we have not only just landscape painters, but painters who just specialize doing seascapes or doing moonlight scenes or scenes with horses or things like that. But that would be number four in the hierarchy. So same with the still life, which is going to be number five. It's also a latecomer. It's also pretty much since 17th century started to be kind of start to show up, and not being in the same par with any of the others, but it still is a quiet life of inanimate objects. Maybe not as significant as historical painting, but very focused on beauty of material things around us, which bring us joy and even instruct us with its symbolism. English term still life comes from Dutch still leven, meaning motionless nature. So those objects also created by God, and therefore if we worthily depict them, we return again credits to the creator. So today, I chose my slides as my images beyond those you are seeing now to zoom in a little bit more or select them to talk about them. I start in that historical hierarchy of subject matter and preeminence, and as we continue our lecture series, we'll cover all of those subject matters. So those are the traits we think we try to expose or see. So we start from historical paintings of that genre and then go further. But before we go further, I have one more question here to ask my audience. When we try to describe God, what are the attributes? What we think when somebody says, can you describe God? What words come to your mind? And of course, you might say, well, obviously, majestic, correct? Beautiful, awesome, awe-inspiring, infinite, omnipresent, also loving, merciful, kind, forgiving, just. We think of dignity, truth, depth, honor, holiness, vastness, timelessness. And I can go on and on and on because it is as timeless as it is whom it's giving a credit to. So I also chose a great fine art which carries its own traits borrowed from God, and it's imbued in them, not in such a vast numbers as God would himself command, but it's borrowed from God. What the fine art carries on? Power, dignity, holiness, truth, depth, honor, and more. So when we think of a great art, do we often think of those things? Probably not, because the way art had been transformed nowadays and so many turbulences and tumultuous style changes and modernity coming in and going out and things which are still in great confusion. But when we look back to the art which defied the time, which became timeless, which overcome centuries of the changes and still remains with us, in other words, great fine art, great masters, whom we call them great masters for the right reason. This art is definitely carries on those great traits, power, dignity, holiness, truth, depth, honor, and more, as I say. And finally, as we explore great spiritual treasury of fine art, I will aid you with quotes from many great artists, more quotes than what we read few. And first I thought kind of play a trick on you and not to tell you who these people were, and you might have thought this is probably theologians or saints or some great church father spoken, but it ends up it's Goya and Rembrandt and Michelangelo and Leonardo. So you discover that commonality there, because godliness is what is really a commonality in those quotes, and really true purpose of why, what they are doing and why, and what they discovered as they discovered art was, true art was. So I want to convey that godliness in a real true art. I'm working on a book myself where these lectures probably will end up. I'm hoping that I will put it all in writing, and sometimes in the future we will have it as a book. But anyway, so after this essential preview and sight of beautiful Michelangelo's head of the Virgin Mary you are seeing now, let us carry on our journey forward. So let's analyze this painting we're seeing now. This is by great Dutch master Rembrandt van Rijn, and it's called The Jewish Bride. What do we see here? The most touching tenderness, that's what we see. Look at the loving husband, so much dignity is there. Care, gentleness, so much love. Great masters were not great because they had only great skills. But like great explorers or archaeologists, they discovered hidden riches of beauty. Inner world, pure emotions, they discovered it and brought them to light for us to see it. They were not selfish, they were sharing those discoveries. They were not mere craftsmen, yet amazing craftsmen too at that. They were visionaries, they knew how to see. Thanks to them, we can see too now, after so many centuries. Beauty is all around us, you know, but it takes a great artist to see it and to share it. Then we see it too with the great artist's eyes. They saw, they felt, and they understood. Is this an ordinary couple we're looking at? Is this an image of Isaac and Rebecca maybe? One thing is clear. It's an extraordinary painting, image of inner beauty. It's not the subject matter which must be most special. It's how it had been seen, transformed, rendered, and experienced. So we are seeing same painting here, just close up of a hand. These hands speak volumes without faces. Just by looking on those hands, we can feel all the warmth and tender, loving care. This is true love, and great painting can convey it perfectly. So let's not forget this. So when we stand in front of great paintings, let's not just breeze through. Let's not just walk by quickly. Let's stand, let's study, let's observe, and let's discover, and we will see many, many things there. This old man also by the brush of Rembrandt. Here too, I will point out his hands. This old man had a long life. These hands had known much work and toil, I would say. Just hands here can say so many things. And of course face. It's not outward likeness, as I said, but a whole long life of old men can unfold in front of us as we look at him. A picture is nothing but a bridge between the soul of the artist and that of the spectator, wrote great French artist Eugène Delacroix. Through the wisdom of Rembrandt, our heart and soul can connect to this cedar. That is too a beauty. Now, this portrait is not necessarily a masterpiece we are looking at. It's not by Rembrandt or any great master. It's a very well executed, of course, nice portrait indeed, but it is here for the person who is depicted in it. And that man is a great French writer, 19th century, Stendhal. When Stendhal visited Florence, his love and anticipation of greatest treasures of beauty was so strong that he was overtaken by very powerful emotions. He could not control his feelings. I mean, if you really feel and connect with the greatness of art and the beauty and the history and the literature and poetry, and you are in Florence, where Michelangelo, Leonardo, Donatello, Dante Alighieri, they walked, they created their masterpieces, filled and overflowed your heart. They overflow your heart and make it ecstatic. So this man was on the edge of fainting just because he was in presence in a holy place for him, a special place for him, in presence of great beauty. Like suddenly, and for the first time, being transported in front of someone you love. That's a kind of feeling. Great art is capable to do that, to touch so deeply chords of our hearts that it reaches to the most unexplored depth. We must learn to appreciate beauty. Learn to see it. It's not to be cold, but have hearts ablaze, really. It is a work of God manifested through beauty. He did it. He created it. Why should we be cold? We should be warm. We should be happy. We should be excited. That's why. So, it's on our knees that we should study the beautiful, wrote another great French master, great painter, Ingres. Stay emotional. Your emotional response, which Stendhal had as well and experienced, actually acquired a name. It's called the Stendhal syndrome. Actually, it's a real thing. We do not need to imitate anyone's emotions. We have our own. We just have to open our hearts to beauty, and it will feel it to brim. So we have to understand when we stand in front of a great piece of art, it is a great piece of art. It's a great piece of a human being's aspiration. And it is great only because of the its service to the even greater cause, which is God. Beauty is just a tool. It's a discovery. It's a way to reach out to heaven. Art is a visual language also. It is silent, yet it speaks most profoundly. So we have to learn to listen to it without hearing words, but seeing it. It does not need to manifest itself with great force, but softly. That's why we have to contemplate, we have to be a little bit meditative in front of it. It touches our heart and heart starts to respond. God spoke to Elijah, as we remember, through gentle breeze, not through the thunder and lightning. We just have to want to listen. What are other languages heart speaks? I was thinking, well, there's the one language heart speaks called music. How about poetry? All of them together with painting, sculpture, architecture, literature, all are children of same parent called beauty. Heart does not speak English, French, Italian, or Chinese per se. It speaks universal language of beauty and understands it. Therefore, it is universal and everybody understands it. So this painting we're here seeing, representing Muses, could be our own impression or impersonification of close relationship of art, music, and poetry. If I could make musicians out of all of you, you would benefit as painters. Everything is harmonious in nature, wrote Ingres, again, the great French painter. We will see that harmony is, if we study a beauty, we see that harmony. So what a joy it could be if we find beauty. Like little children, we will get excited. Suddenly, like a cataract lifted off our eyes, we would see God's amazing work and His stunning creation. It is all around us, but its ability to discover it suddenly makes it so clear. We all often search for miracles. They're all here, they're all around us, and art is one of those wonderful ways to see them. But we must learn how to find it, though. We learn how to see it. For example, I would say museums, I often speak to my students, museums are best places to search for it. Masters observed, it's not in front of the most beautiful sunset or majestic waterfall, one exclaims, I want to be an artist, but in front of a great works of art in a museum, something done by human hands. Because great artists are intercessors. Here, Orthodox Christians, we're very familiar with intercessors as the saints who've been intercessors to God. We understand how that works. So like saints intercede to God, so great artists who run this same race, they found beauty. They are successful. They ran that race successfully. They got to the end. They made it. They found beauty. They show it to us and make it easier for us to discover God's majestic creation. Truly, that's how what intercessor would do. They intercede to God through their beautiful discoveries. Make us aware of it. Bring us closer to it. It helped to go through the heart and eyes of one human being to another. Nature holds the beautiful for the artist who has the insight to extract it, wrote great German master Albrecht Dürer. So, we're seeing a few images here in front of a Rembrandt painting in a museum here, and or a Mughal painting, beautiful miniature. So it does not matter. The language of art is universal, whether it's Mughal India, or if it is a Japanese woodblock print, or if it is a great masterpiece by El Greco, it does not matter. They all serve the same master. If they are truly done in the way they should be, and they are. This beautiful Leonardo shows us again and again that true fine art is universal. Another feature of beauty, so if you want to see what are the features of beauty, what makes beauty what it is, because it could be subjective. People say, well, for you this is beauty, for me that is beauty, but it's not loosey-goosey. It does have a specific traits. It has a specific description, specific features. It's living almost. So the one feature of the art, the true fine art, is its universality. That is another feature of fine art, therefore of the beauty. Along with what? Timelessness. That's another feature. It have to be timeless. Universality's defining characteristic of beauty, and truly beautiful has no expiration date. What means timelessness? It means that it is beautiful and relevant today. It will be tomorrow, it was yesterday and day before, and will be day after. It overcomes test of times, as we mentioned, remains relevant in every century. So there is a time is a good test. So if maybe today we're in the midst of art around us, that art have to still go through, have to go through catalysts, you have to go through time testing. We don't know it yet, whether it will make it or not. And I have some very serious doubts about that. So-called art, which is raging today, may be called contemporary, but it should not be called modern, actually. We call it modern art. How often we have seen, and let me give you an example, how often we have seen some ancient art, maybe ancient Greek statue or a Roman architecture or a sculpture or even ancient coin, and exclaimed, it's so modern. It does not mean it's like artwork being created in our times. It really means I relate to it. I understand it. I like it. I'm moved by it. Therefore, it is not thing of the past. It's just as modern than anything else I can connect to. You know, honestly, rocks and the stones lying around in our backyards are very ancient also, but not necessarily very valuable or beautiful just for being old. So great artists who captured beauty captured immortality, that's another trait, and timelessness, as I said. That's why true work of art defeated time and also reaches out to every nationality. Art was given to humankind in the very beginning, and it's integral part of striving of a human soul. God reveals himself in beauty, imbuing immortality to everything it touches. That's what makes ancient modern. So let us recognize his works in great masterpieces of art. I don't relate to a lot of art created, for example, today, simply because it rejected beauty. Therefore, it signed its death warrant. It will fade away. It will not survive test of times. Great artists knew true values of art and therefore adhered to it. Simple as that, knowing it will be their ticket to eternity. Modernity and beauty of this portrait, which is over 500 years old, attest to that. So look at it and enjoy it and see how beautiful it is. So what are the timeless things? Things which do not change. Let's see, skies. Skies are the same as thousands of years ago. Trees, mountains, human being too. In other words, created world, world which was made tangible, visible, recognizable, clear by God. Things may change, right? For us through customs, fashions, technology, but inner man remains same with values of love, friendship, repentance, charity, tenderness and care. Great and true art depicts visible world, not abstract, and conveys inner value and characteristics of it. What made Italian Renaissance, for example, important to artist's life, amongst many other things, but primarily the fact that artists rose above the status of craftsmen. Renaissance men, we heard it, not merely a painter, but also a sculptor, architect, philosopher, poet, musician, engineer, like Leonardo or Michelangelo were, all in one. Artists contained all these traits and because became equal to all other venerable callings of time. Artist's work was not utilitarian, but depth of his knowledge of many things made it food for the soul, food for thought, something for betterment of men. Craftsman was replaced by artist. Art became so important, so powerful, so all-encompassing that it became useless as a single utilitarian, mercantile, practical thing. We know we don't eat art, we don't support some building with the picture, it doesn't have that kind of use. It's not a practical thing, but like love, this priceless one started to satisfy inner man, fed soul, and elevated the mind. So it's not being used in a technical aspect of being things used, but it's being bigger than that. It's beyond the use. This is Michelangelo's David, his head, the portrait. Great spirit of elevated mind is so visible in his features. It's a man, crown of creation, which inspires and gives confidence. I should be sorry, my Lord, if I have only succeeded in entertaining them. I wish to make them better. wrote great composer Frederick Handel. I like to repeat this quote often, because art through beauty makes us better. This Michelangelo's David is not there to make us scared or drag us down or depress us. It makes us strong, makes us want to reach for the highest achievements. This remarkable face of shepherd adoring a newborn Jesus from great Italian painter Ghirlandaio. Is the detail from his picture. Ghirlandaio was actually Michelangelo's teacher. This face says it all. I cannot even describe to how meaningful this expression of joy, grace, amazement, humility, hope, and therefore true humanity can be read in his eyes. Semi-open mouth, his expression, that is a portrait powerfully conveying God dwelling in the true art through beauty. My father, Robert Chocheli, who was and continues to be my lifelong instructor, who made me aware of great art of the masters, along with skills of an artist, always taught me that. Main object of fine art is human being, remember. Main object of fine art is human being. Art have to serve it. Everyone has individual imagination and fantasy, of course, but it must be tailored to one thing, human being, human understanding. It's not just depicting human in art, let me be clear. But whether it's even a landscape or still life, it have to appeal to human. That's why I said the religious art is not just a religious subject matter. Human spirit elevates and have to be elevated and must relate and embrace human. Be dialogue, not a monologue. When artist is all about himself, it is a monologue. It says me, 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 me. Artist, which is engaging us in dialogue, it says, let's talk about it. I want to share with you this. I want you to be better. I want you to be encouraged. I want you to be inspired. That's what great art does. It's not about me, not selfish. We know that as Orthodox Christians, when iconographers do not sign their beautiful icons because it goes, glory goes to God. And if they do sign it, they say, through the hands of such and such. Because it goes through the hands of the artist, goes to God. Because God is the whom it is credited. We're just brushes in his hands. So it's not selfish, not an idea without representation which cannot reach out to another human. Not like art created nowadays, when you don't know that picture is even upside down or even it's a picture at all. Man is made in God's image, and art which rejects human being is anti-human really. And beauty is that goal through which artist has to achieve true humanity. Also same way my mother, Leila Chocheli, who was my teacher as well as my father, grew up in a family of artists, she was my lifelong art inspiration and still is, would always point that to me. That artist has to achieve true humanity through love, through humility, through giving. If one considered life as a simple loan, one would perhaps be less exacting. We possess actually nothing. Everything goes through us, wrote great French artist Delacroix. So art is not ours. It's God's. Sooner we know that, better. And artists have a sacred duty to share it and do best possible job as one recognizes greatness of God's gift. That's a high standard we have to reach if we want to be artists. And if we are spectators, if we are not artists and we're just enjoying art, and art should be a big part of our lives, then we should be as well immersed into that spirit. Here is a funerary statue by Italian Renaissance sculptor Tullio Lombardo, depicting a heroic warrior, Guidorello Guidorelli. In statue, he's depicted as dead, but through great art, he lives through centuries. Look how alive he looks, even he is not alive. This is great fresco by Raphael called School of Athens. Wonderful example of power of human thought and highest aspirations. Painting is the grandchild of nature. It is related to God, said once Rembrandt. And indeed, absolutely, God should always be on top. He's creator of all. So if we are children of our Heavenly Father, and if we are also made as crown of creation in His image, then art we produce will be a grandchild of God. Rembrandt correctly points to God as ultimate creator, nature as its child, and painting as a grandchild. It is one harmonious family, really. If we imagine a pyramid, God is at the top of shape, streams down to middle part, which is human, and ends with a wide base, which is art, a product of that human being. Our priorities in understanding of art must be God-centric, and in this, and this is very important. I had been and will be quoting this remarkable master. You heard me already saying the anger, the French genius of 19th century. This is his beautiful masterpiece alongside with remarkable artistic output. Anger gave us a very clear aesthetic system. He was a good writer. His writings and quotes are profound, and I quote him often, right? Note grace, softness, lifelikeness, and even more, something monumental and timeless in this painting. And he said, art should only depict beauty. If you wish to see that leg as ugly, I am sure you will find reasons. But I say to you, borrow my eyes and you will see it as beautiful. We should learn to see things with an eye of a great artist. Then we see nature transfigured. Now, as I am showing you this remarkable creation of human being, masterpiece which is truly walks on God's footsteps, I continue to feel strong emotions of standing in front of a miracle. This is Rembrandt's Return of the Prodigal Son. I was very young when I saw this first in person, in my early teens, and it really struck me. Father here is depicted as old and fragile and even blind, but look how much love, how much tenderness, joy, assurance that beloved son once lost and now found is here. He touches him. He feels his back. He does not need to see. Whole depths of parable unfolds like a perfect sermon, bringing us into a sheer immense joy of the Father. A painting is complete when it has the shadows of God, once Rembrandt wrote. Shadows and lights of loving Christ breathe supernatural life in this true masterpiece. And how about repentant prodigal son? Look at this picture, his worn out cloth with holes, calloused feet, buried head in the bosom of all-forgiving father. Father's hands feeling his son are pinnacle. So that is an image of beauty. Its truthfulness, that's another trait of beauty. Beauty is truth. How does God see us? He sees good in us. Icon can be covered with grime, candle sooth, even dirt, but underneath is a beautiful and pure icon. So if we clean it off, comes back again the shining image. So we're walking icons, some of us cracked and damaged. We've heard this before. We're covered with dust, but repentance immediately wipes out the dust and repairs the cracks, and underneath is pure and beautiful image. Saint Gabriel, full of Christ of Georgia, once said, I am paraphrasing, that he never met a bad person. So great landscape here, where's great landscape master, British painter John Constable, once said, he never seen an ugly thing. How comes today's artists see so much darkness, hopelessness, and despair? That existed before too. We can't say we are the only ones having those things. They had their plagues, they had their wars and invasions and disasters. Art is all about beauty. And that's what art was used for, to pull out of that, to point to God and say there is hope. The beauty is the truth. So we're discovering that beauty is useless, beauty is timeless, beauty is elevating, beauty is truth, beauty is transformative, stirring, ennobling, and reflection of divine. See all these traits we started with talking about. Greek word for perceive is aesthetic. And one have to perceive beauty. And it will transform our life to something higher and deeper. Times we live in should not alter or subdue our perception. Beauty is above any given time, Why do we still listen to sublime sounds of Mozart's music? You heard it in the beginning of the lecture, how divine, how beautiful it was. And in standing awe in front of Leonardo, Rembrandt or Rubens, because beauty does not expire. It overcomes time, like timeless stories of humankind. This is a sacrifice of Isaac by Rembrandt. And it all there, timeless story, timeless beauty, timeless truth, and timeless presence of God in all of it. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. We quote Matthew 5:16. Does not great art glorify Father in heaven? Its sole purpose is just that. Therefore, would be no unbelievers if we were the Christians we should be. Everyone would convert to godliness if we generally kept the commandments of Christ, wrote profoundly St. John Chrysostom. World and humanity will be so transformed in glory if artists serve true God with true beauty today. Again, paraphrasing St. John Chrysostom, everyone would convert to godliness if we generally kept the commandments. Well, that's why we draw inspiration and strength from great masters of the olden days who kept their commandments, who lived in pursuit of beauty. This is Michelangelo's Pietà. He was 23 years old when he created it, this timeless masterpiece. Words of French architect and art critic André Philibien, I mentioned earlier, his quote comes to mind, which I see this astonishing marble glorifying God in beauty. He wrote, "Those paintings must have something great, something arresting and extraordinary, able to surprise, please, and instruct, and this is what we call fine taste. By these do common things become beautiful, and beautiful things sublime and inspiring. For in painting, fine taste, sublimity, and inspiration are the same thing. Its tongue is silent, it is true, but everything in it speaks." Well, this is a credo, this is a creed of those greats which we are learning and discovering about. And even if it's written about painting, it's applicable to sculpture as well, to art in general, and to this statue in particular. Now, there are so many wonderful paintings, wonderful art out there. No matter how many I will attempt to compile, there is more. It's like wisdom. Wise sayings of the thinkers and philosophers and great men and saints, you never exhaust that wisdom. And we always need it. We always benefit, always need more. Beauty had been found, generously shared, lovingly given to us by great artists. I selected works here, and some very known, and some are maybe less known, but all united in the same purpose, to give glory to Creator. Not every artist was believer, as I mentioned, or we know was a Christian, but whether intentionally or not, by capturing beauty, they praised God. Maybe one day they discovered this in heaven, that what they've done was their saving grace. But for us today, most of these artists who were devoted to the beauty, devoted to the truth of the beauty, they were devoted to God. And they were, many of them, truly devoted people as well. And they were believers as well, of course. This angel is by Leonardo da Vinci. Note softness and grace, inner light, and how it radiates from here. So I would like to stop at this beautiful image, as we will hear the rest of the Laudate Dominum by Mozart, and look again some of those beautiful images we just explored, and hope to meet up with you again and continue our presentation and go even further and further and discover joys of great fine art. Thank you very much.